tenor. Give me a round of juice boxes and a shot of O2 for my girl over here. Girl, this is my jam. This is my jam. Let's go round two. Shots, 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 shots.
Wait, I don't think it's safe to drive.
You know what? You're right. We should just call a cab. And I'm ready for some shots. The women come around every time I'm pouring shots. Patron's on the rocks, and I'm ready for some shots. The women come around. Hey, Metro. This is Hassan Shah giving you the Mile High Scoop on what goes on in Denver. Right.
And I'm Annalisa Blanco, your inside source to everything in Hollywood.
Entertainment is your connection to the hottest celebrities, whether it's in Denver or Hollywood.
So make sure to check us out every week on Met Radio and the Met Report. Also, follow us on Twitter and become a fan on Facebook. We'll see you on campus.
Welcome back. And now Leanna Duarte joins us to tell us everything about Hollywood. All
right. Hey Metro, I'm Leanna Duarte, and I'm here to bring you the latest juicy gossip from the Mile High to the streets of Hollywood. Let's start off on the East Coast. The US Open kicked off August 29th, and a few celebs you may recognize made an appearance over Labor Day weekend. Celebrities like Blake Lively, Vanessa Hudgens, and Alec Baldwin, and Entourage star Adrian Grenner, who, as always, was looking very sexy, were spotted in the stands cheering on their favorite tennis players. For all the Reese Witherspoon fans out there, the Oscar-winning actress was hit by a car while jogging in Santa Monica earlier this week. Her reps have confirmed that she is resting comfortably in her home. Now, for my lovely ladies, who's excited for the new Bachelor season? I know I am, especially because of the lucky man who is in the center of attention, Ben Flanick. The 28-year-old Sonoma winemaker will be the next Bachelor. I've got some important dates for you guys to remember. The 63rd Emmy Awards will be live on September 18th. I am very excited to see our favorite celebrities will be wearing and who will win. Don't worry, E-Met fans, we will be covering who is hot and who is not. Also, for all you Trubies out there, do not forget the season 4 finale of True Blood is this weekend on HBO. I know, I'm really upset that I have to wait another year until the new season comes out, too. This week will also be a very sad day for Entourage and Rescue Me fans. Both series will be ending this week, so make sure to check out the final episodes for each series. We couldn't help but end with an outrageous fan who made us look really bad when Lil Wayne was in town. Really, dude? You were that excited about Lil Wayne that you had to jump right on stage in the middle of his performance? Thanks for giving the rest of us Denver fans a bad reputation. Well, that's it for this week's entertainment. Back to you guys at the desk.
Thanks, Leanna. Lots going on in Hollywood this week.
Absolutely. Our own Annalisa Blanco was in Aspen this week, catching up with the cast of the CBS soap opera, The Bold and the Beautiful.
I can't give away too many details. You know, I gotta keep some things under wraps. But basically, it's my character, Hope, and then Scott Clifton's character Liam and Jackie McInnes Wood, who plays Steffi, the three of us are all out here and we get to enjoy this gorgeous scenery. Seriously, we could just play in Aspen, but you know, there's some work too. We're working up on top of Mount Ajax right now, which is where we are. And we're filming, I'll just say that some characters are united.
Be sure to keep watching the Met Report for our in-depth interviews with the cast.
You know, I think it was a really great opportunity for the Met Report to actually go up in Aspen and be able to spend time on the set of The Bold and the Beautiful.
And there's no better place to be this time of year. When we return, Paul Ruelas joins us with the latest in sports from Roadrunners to the Rockies. Keep it here.
The Rocky Mountain Athletic Conference is one of the most historic college organizations in the United States. Founded in 1909, the RMAC has a membership of 14 colleges and universities, making it one of the largest conferences in the country. The RMAC is also one of the most successful. During the past decade, more than 30 RMAC teams have won national championships. The Rocky Mountain Athletic Conference, continuing the tradition of excellence.
Welcome back. Paula Ruelas is in the studio to bring us This Week in Sports. So Paula, it looks like the Roadrunners had a really great weekend. Do you think we've got a good season ahead of us?
Well guys, based on their performance this past weekend, I'd really like to think so. But there's so much more time left in the season that we really can't get too ahead of ourselves. So why don't we check out how great they did this week?
Great.
It's time to hit the court as our 11th ranked volleyball team opened up their season this past weekend. The Roadrunners played up to their high rankings, sweeping King College and Finlay on day one of the Ore Digger Classic. In day two, they decimated the second best team in the tournament, St. Cloud State, with the final score of 3-0. Time for some highlights as the Roadrunners look to go 4-0 the entire tournament. The team took on Northwood University from Michigan in the tournament's finale. First set, Emily Greenhall throws it down for one of her 11 kills in the match. Then preseason year player of the year, Bree Morley, pounding out the kill, and Metro wins 25-17 in set one. Into the second set, not fan with the serve, and who's going to take it? Looks like no one wanted it. Metro wins set two, 25-17. Third set, and new transfer Alyssa Heath finds an opening, giving her team the early lead. Then a couple new faces with the block, and the Roadrunners go on to sweep Northwood to remain undefeated on the season. Head coach Debbie Hendricks gives us her thoughts on the great start.
I tell you what, when we're in system and we are, you know, bringing a swarm mentality, we're tough. You know, we've got weapons in every position, especially at the pins. And, you know, I think that we were very aggressive for most of the weekend.
Last Friday, the women took on Upper Iowa in a hard-fought battle, winning 3-2 on an own goal by the Peacocks. On Sunday, the women played against McPherson with the lack of offense. It started to look like a repeat of Friday until the second half. And that's where we'll start. Game tied until midfielder Becca Medina takes the free kick and cranks the shot over the goalkeeper to go up one. Trying for her second goal of the day, and she does it. Or does she? It was determined that the ball went off the keeper's back and counted as an own goal. So only one goal for Medina on the day. Back to the scoring with Carissa Price getting in on the action, making it 4-1. Freshman Abby Rolfe also netting one, scoring her first career goal with the great cross. Somebody looks happy about that one. With Medina getting denied her second goal, someone had to get two, and why not it be Rolfe? She gets the tap-in from Tess Hangelock's cross pass and makes it 2 for the game. The runners roll to an easy 6-1 victory. After the game, we spoke with Becca Medina, and here's what she had to say.
I'm going to try to keep scoring, but definitely just try to be a distributor and help other people score as well.
On to men's soccer now, as they opened their season against Upper Iowa this past Friday. While the women fought tooth and nail with the Peacocks, the men didn't have any troubles finding the back of the net. First half, Chris Yoder with the rock, no one covering the midfielder, and he gets the wide open shot for the first goal of the game. Great Metro passing by Ryan Warren finds Mendes, who goes top shelf for goal number 2. It was also Warren's second assist of the game, and the goals kept on coming. Still the first half, Scott Grody on the set piece and beats the keep for his first hat trick, and he would add 2 more for his first collegiate hat trick. And how about one more for good measure? TJ Tebow leaves the perfect pass for Scott Crawford, and he has no problem finishing for the sweet goal. Metro State clobbers Upper Iowa 8-1 to start off the season on the right track. Now, Sunday's game was not as exciting as it was a tight match against University of Mary the entire game. Metro held a 2-1 lead until the final seconds, 25 seconds of the when the Marauders scored to tie things up. And that's where it would end after two overtimes. Metro heads on the road to Seattle for next weekend's matchups. Have you ever wanted to go onto Coors Field, Sports Authority Field at Mile High, or on the court at the Pepsi Center? Well, now you can get that chance while also giving back to a great cause by running in the 6th annual Fans on the Field 10K 5K Run. This event benefits the National Sports Center for the Disabled, and it will take place on September 25th, starting at Coors Field. This event was sold out last year, so make sure to sign up soon, and you can do that at www.fansonthefield.com. And as baseball season comes to a close, it appears it will not be a Rocktober this year. Watch as I show you why that is. At the start of the 2011 Major League Baseball season, the Rockies were deemed the team to beat in the National League West.
These expectations were high because of the contract extensions of both Tulo and Cargo, returning players such as Helton and Fowler, and new talent like Ty Wigginton joining the team.
In April, the Rockies had a 17-8 record, making them the number one team in the NL West and the third best team in the majors. At the time, it seemed the Rockies were well on their way to meeting those high expectations. So what happened?
You had expectations this year. You have to sit down in the offseason and get away from the emotional part of it. Figure out why you had those expectations, figure out where they came up short.
The expectations certainly became unrealistic as the injury bug began to bite. Pitcher Jorge De La Rosa underwent season-ending Tommy John surgery in May, while pitcher Juan Acasio underwent neck surgery. Promising young outfielder Charlie Blackman is also out due to a fractured left foot, which occurred July 7th. So far, there have been a total of 29 injuries the Rockies had to bear, which would be crippling for any team.
De La Rosa had the Tommy John surgery, so you lost your three main guys. So it's been a piecemeal thing from that point on.
The injuries, especially those of the starting pitchers, have caused the bullpen to wear down, leading to the many struggles they faced on the mound.
Well, I just think it was overused, overtaxed. It's like anything else. You keep pulling on a rubber band and eventually it'll break, you know. If you use a rubber band properly, it can last a long time. But if you pull on it all the time, you're going to eventually break it. I think that's what happens with the bullpen.
The mediocre pitching performance has landed the Rockies as third worst in the NL with a 4.39 ERA. Despite putting up a lot of runs, they gave up just as many. Hopefully, the starting rotation can provide more relief next season. Ultimately, the poor ERA hindered the Rockies, and as the end of the regular season nears, their chances of making the playoffs is a feeble less than 1%, leaving their fans and Dinger disappointed. For Met Report Sports, I'm Paula Ruelas.
Wow, it looks like the Rockies had a rough season, but at least some of the fans are still going to be able to have some fun at the ballpark.
You know, as fans, we're always seeing the field from the stands or from TV. It would be quite interesting to have a point of view from right on the field.
Definitely.
Absolutely.
Well, that will do it for this week's edition of the Met Report. For Kelly Matzner, Rosario Chavarria, Leanna Duarte, and Paula Ruelas, I'm Benjamin Smith, and we'll see you on campus.